Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to you all. And it's tremendous to see how many of you braved the elements to get here today. There's an important metaphor in that, since there are an awful lot of elements these days to brave. But there are also tremendous opportunities. And we're here today to have what promises to be a very rich discussion about one big piece of that story, which is the role of the private sector in global sustainable development. My name is Elizabeth Cousins. I'm the Deputy Chief Executive Officer of the UN Foundation, and I'm delighted to open this event and to introduce the issue and our keynote speaker, Lord Mark Malloch-Brown. Let me start by extending warm thanks to John MacArthur and his colleagues at the Brookings Institution, not only for convening this important discussion, but also for years of intellectual and policy leadership that has really helped shape the agenda we're here to discuss. So we're here today for a conversation about business and sustainable development. We will hear about the path-breaking work of the Business and Sustainable Development Commission, an impressive and diverse group of 40 corporate and public leaders who came together at the beginning of 2016 to examine the business case for sustainable development. Their recently released report, Better Business, Better World, not only outlines a powerful business case, but they outline it at scale, and they outline it with a level of granularity in key sectors and geographies that is truly compelling. In a moment, Mark will speak to the report's findings and implications, so let me offer just a few opening observations. First, it's no secret that we live in a time of shifting sands, the elements we're all trying to brave. Business in all its forms, just like citizens, just like governments and institutions, are navigating that terrain and trying to find ways to understand trends, to anticipate turbulence, and to spot new equilibria. We're all in the game of looking for signals from the future, even while we also need to focus on the day-to-day churn or the quarterly earnings. One set of signals comes from the Sustainable Development Goals, or SDGs, that were agreed at the end of 2015 to drive long-term prosperity and inclusive and sustainable growth by 2030. Everyone involved in crafting those goals, which were adopted by every single country just a year and a half ago, recognize that they will only be achieved if private capital and businesses new and old align their business models with the direction of travel of those goals. Now, interestingly, we've seen a pretty rapid and substantial interest among business leaders in the SDGs, I think in part because they help send that signal about future trends and long-term value. Second, it's also no secret that we live in a divisive time. Rising inequality has contributed to an erosion of trust in institutions, including between societies and business. When the 8 richest men in the world command the same wealth as the poorest 3.6 billion, half the planet, we have a problem. But here, too, business has a shifting role. Now, many of you will be familiar with something called the Edelman Trust Barometer that analyzes trust along multiple dimensions in 28 countries around the world and has been doing that for nearly 20 years. This year's barometer, not surprisingly, found trust at rock bottom. No sector did well. CEO credibility dropped to an all-time low of 37%. But compared to government, compared to NGOs, compared to media, business commanded comparatively greater trust and confidence. Business was viewed as the only sector that could make a difference, and a significant majority believed that companies could take actions that both increase their profits and improve conditions in the communities where they operate. That's extremely encouraging, and it speaks to a very different kind of way that businesses and business leaders can project themselves in the world, in their markets, and in their communities. And the Sustainable Development Goals also give an important framework for that leadership. Last, I'll say just a quick word about the UN. The UN Foundation was started nearly 20 years ago by a businessman, Ted Turner, who believed that business could be a strong partner for the UN and a solution maker for global problems. And in those two decades, we've seen a sea change in how the UN works with the private sector. Now, the UN today has a new Secretary General, Antonio Guterres, who has spoken about the alignment of the core business of the private sector with the strategic goals of the international community. And if we recognize that alignment, and if we act intentionally in relation to it, it's incredibly powerful and again speaks to the signals we want from the future and that our actions have the real potential to produce. So with that, it is now my distinct pleasure to introduce Lord Mark Malloch-Brown. Mark really needs no introduction in this room or in the world. He's a former Deputy Secretary General of the United Nations, as well as a former administrator of the UN Development Program. He has served with distinction in his own country in the Cabinet and Foreign Office of the United Kingdom. He is active in both the business and nonprofit world. He is passionate about human dignity and betterment. And he's, of course, the chair of the Business and Sustainable Development Commission. So please join me in welcoming Mark to the stage.
Well, I always sort of feel coming to Brookings, it's kind of almost coming home, so it's nice to be home. I've spoken, I suspect, to many of you before. And thank you for those who've made it out in this horrific weather to get here this afternoon. And thank you particularly to Brookings and to the whole home team of John MacArthur and Homi and George Ingram and others who've, made this happen. Those of you who may remember me at the World Bank, and there are a number of my old colleagues there, will know that from those days onwards, I've persistently and consistently pushed for getting a bigger business involvement in development. It's really, at one level, just been a matter of resources. The development activities of civil society and the public sector are critical but not sufficient, and that's becoming, I think, ever more true as we move forward. But I've watched the curve of growing business engagement in development over the last 20 years, and I felt very strongly we'd reached a point where there was a need for a step change. The CEOs, many of them who have worked on this commission and on this report, Better Business, Better World, our CEOs who've already themselves made that step change. And what is that? It's to take a great leap beyond what we call CSR to the whole world of development as an issue of profit and loss, development as a core business activity, which is sustainable because the business makes money from it and therefore can go on doing it. And that simple proposition, is at the core, really, of this report, that intractable development problems can be turned into business opportunities. Now, I'm going to come to all the qualifications and caveats around that because, stated that way, it sounds sort of rather hard market and ruthless in its potential, and that's not what is meant. But we felt, and the starting point for this was a very different political environment here and in Europe, even though, as you just heard from John, this thing is a little more than a year old. We felt at the time of that we put this group together that business had shown its power when it's put its weight behind relatively progressive forces of government. And what we had in mind, and the inspiration for this, was the Paris Climate Change Agreement, where our view was that the difference between Paris and the earlier failed negotiation in Copenhagen had been in very considerable part business putting its shoulder behind the idea of an agreement, giving politicians the courage to act, because rather than business sort of chiding them and chasing them all the way to the polls and out of office, business was on side. Business was convinced that managing emissions was critical to its success and critical to the future health and prosperity of its different stakeholders, employees, consumers alike. So we felt on that experience that we could recruit CEOs to what we, in our more exuberant moments, call a movement, because CEOs, the only kind of movement they are used to is a classical step on a dance floor. Movement is what social society does, not what civil society does, not necessarily what business leaders do. But we felt that if we could just engage them and share with them the excitement of this group of CEOs that we've worked with, we could really change and transform business attitudes towards development. Now, in the period, a year and a half later, obviously politics has taken a very different turn to what we had anticipated, and there is a government here in Washington, but, there are governments in prospect in Europe as well, who have a much more skeptical view of this whole development and environmental and climate change agenda. But, our view is that just makes business leadership in this area and business partnership with civil society and business continuing to press at the door of policymakers and regulators around this agenda all the more important. Not a time to give up, but a time to redouble efforts, whether it's trying to protect Paris or whether it's carrying this broader sustainable development agenda forward. And let me sort of just lay out our case as to, our thinking process as we went through the preparation of this report. And, the first was, business isn't being encouraged to step in to help out with development because public development has failed. Quite the contrary. This has been 30 years where we've seen, greater shifts and jumps in poverty reduction globally, in the provision of education, in healthcare and its outcomes, than we've seen at any time in human history. It's also the period when incomes have grown more widely and broadly than at any time in human history. So, it's not that development's failed, it's just the scope and scale of the challenges grown to the point that maybe this train needs a second engine. And that's where the private sector can become such a critical additional partner as we move forward. And, one reason, and the case for that, is not just the quantum of resources and inventiveness that modern development needs to solve the problems. It's that the environment in which we are operating, the economic, political environment, is showing real signs of wear and tear and new conflict. And this preceded, the election of President Trump here or Brexit in the UK. Those are both, if you like, responses to the same thing that consumed our commissioners, our CEOs, which was the acknowledgement that that remarkable miracle 30 years of growth, had a much less comfortable side to it, that it had led, as I'm sure we'll hear in a little while, to massive increases in inequality, that the issues of distribution and inclusion were just becoming ever more extreme, that it had led to extraordinary environmental damage, with the obvious sign being the polluted cities of Asia, where it's hard to take a kid out for in the daytime in Beijing or Shanghai at times now, same in Delhi. The security costs of this particular economic model that we've allowed to run, potentially out of control, with 10% of global GDP now spent on security, as we struggle with the consequences of failed states, of massive immigration and migration movements. So while our commissioners, who come from Asia as well as the US and Europe, look through very different ends of the telescope at the state of the world, with the Asian commissioners still very much seized with the excitement of the economic transformation that they've seen in their countries and societies over recent decades. They too are seeing the costs of the current model in the pollution in their cities, in the fact that, say, China in the last, since 2010, has been growing at half the rate that it was before, and where, structurally they are as much victims of a relative slowdown in growth from what they'd seen before in Asia as we are in the rest of the world. They too see disproportionately in that part of the world the consequences of forced and slave labor, with arguably some tens of millions of people caught up in that trap and prison at the bottom of the workforce and supply chains in their part of the world. So they I think, as much as our Western commissioners, you know, very much buy into this idea of how can we modify the model of globalization, of global growth, in a way which preserves the private sector as a kind of wealth-creating, income-generating, job-creating system, while, in a sense, steering it towards playing a more constructive role in society, doing the kind of things that our commissioners' companies are already doing in terms of the business models that they are adopting. So what we have done in this report is try to make the case that, you know, a more inclusive model of growth backed by business, an environmentally sustainable one which focuses on the business sides of principles of sort of circular economy and shared economy models, is not one which brings the prospect necessarily of lower growth at all, that indeed is one of very considerable opportunity for the private sector. And we, to make this case and take it beyond high concept to something much more real, we looked at four sectors, energy, mobility and urbanization, agricultural and the food system, and health. And in it, we found what we call 60 global hotspots or growth spots and opportunities, worth between them $12 trillion by 2030 on an annualized basis. That, in terms of today's GDP, is a 10% growth in global GDP, and something like mobility is $2 trillion of that, healthcare, $1.6 trillion. And these are not, and this is one of the things about the SDGs which one must emphasize, the SDGs are not a developing country-only set of goals. The whole intention this time was to have goals which worked globally. And so if you take my four sectors, in the case of energy, the move to sustainable energy, the benefits in terms of that extra income generation and wealth creation is spread pretty much evenly between the developed and developing world. Same for the growth spots related to developing and building modern cities. Food and agriculture, not surprisingly, 70% of the growth and jobs is going to be in developing countries. Health, similarly, where there's a big catch-up to make, 40%, according to our analysis. And when we look beyond these four sectors, which we took because we thought they were the main drivers of progress across a whole range of the 17 Sustainable Development Goals, but when we look wider across the goals as a whole, we see a prospect of $20 or $30 trillion annualized GDP growth. Repeated on an annual basis, so lifting global GDP by that amount, rather. And so, you know, we have wanted to say to our commissioner, to say to the audience that our commission tries to reach, this is sustainable because it is genuinely about business opportunities. It is sustainable because those businesses that choose to carry on their current narrow tracks and not jump into these new areas, you know, risk losing out. There's a simple CEO market choice to be made. Stay within traditional, older, lower growth sectors and markets, or have the courage to go into these new sectors. Now, what are the obstacles that we identified? First, you know, business models and how opportunities are assessed with a focus on short-term return, you know, tend to steer away from the big long-term infrastructure spending that a lot of this assumes. This is reinforced by the second problem, capital markets, which are very much, particularly since the financial crisis, with the demands since for high levels of liquidity, very much focused on short-termism, if you like. Policy setting, where the public sector and the policymakers have not really embraced the idea of business as a partner in development, so is still much more focused on regulating and inhibiting business behavior rather than finding ways to incentivize its engagement in these sectors. And finally, market sectors where businesses themselves can be easily tempted in a race to the bottom, squeezing extra profit out of their supply chain by just simply paying people less. People who are not unionized, not protected, have no means to look after themselves. So, you know, we realize there's a big challenge here to overcome these issues. And as a group of commissioners, we've sort of set ourselves in this second year of our life, and we're going to, in a very business-like way, declare our job done and go out of business at the end of the year. In January 2018, we'll have had 2 years to kind of try and make our point and sow the idea and hope others will then carry it forward. First is we're encouraging all those we've reached in terms of business leaders to incorporate these goals into their business models and to ideally make sure they have a director or senior part of senior management who will keep the company honest, who will make sure they're pursuing this in their business strategies. Secondly, that sectors work together. You're going to hear from Barry Parkin of Mars, which is, you know, a classic case of a company which works with its competitors to make sure that round issues of environmental conservation of the basic commodity, cocoa, but also around labor supply and supply chain issues, you know, basic standards are met. That the competition between confectioners comes at later stages in the process around the marketing, etc., etc., and the competition cost is not borne on the backs of the poorest and those who can least afford it. The third issue is that we're sort of working with the multilateral development banks, the MDBs, with the aid sector and others around this whole issue of blended finance. Everybody talks a great game on it, but the actual volumes of public-private finance going into the tough stuff like infrastructure, actually in developed countries as well as developing countries, is disappointingly low. So, you know, a real sort of push to see how we can free this to make it really, really happen. But I want to just finish with what I've called since the beginning of this exercise, and, you know, it shows that, you know, I'm a come lately businessman. I've only had to, my business career was both at the beginning of my career and now at the end with expensive kids to educate, as I always grumble to them. So what I'm about to say may well hark back to my World Bank and UN days, which is none of this works if business is not, in a sense, taking on a social contract with civil society and with government. Why has there been such a long skepticism of business in development? It's really been because development is about the poorest of the poor. It's about the most vulnerable. It's about those with least rights. So for business to come in and propose solutions, you know, is not going to work unless it is a business which is signing up to labor standards, environmental standards, to transparency about where and how much tax it pays, about respect for all sorts of sets of different workers' rights. And, you know, this social contract concept is central to our argument. It's the way to win the license to operate, if I can put it that way. And so to the very, very final point, I've talked about how we get that capital into these areas, but I think it's incredibly important. I said that, you know, business can solve problems that have been intractable long-term development problems. And, you know, this report of ours, which I really do recommend, if you didn't manage to get one of the precious copies left here, do go online and find it, because, you know, it is littered, and actually the online version is, if anything, even better, because you can jump to the case studies and everything else behind it. But, you know, it is just full of the stories, not just of the application of capital, but as importantly, the application of innovation. And, you know, the disruptive impact of new technologies applied to persistent development problems. And, you know, Bob Collymore, the very well-known chairman of CEO of M-Pesa, the mobile money system in Kenya, is a member of the commission. But it doesn't anymore stop with that. Safaricom, his company, you know, is now the sort of base technology for M-Kopa, which is a solar lighting system that 500,000 houses in Kenya and East Africa are now equipped with, and where you pay the lease payments over your mobile phone. And if you don't pay them, you get your solar panel switches off on the roof. And so we're just seeing a disruptive impact across all development sectors, from financial inclusion. Brookings did a report noting that hundreds of millions, 300 to 400 million people had come into the financial sector in recent years. Disproportionately, that's because of mobile banking. Now we're seeing the same disruptive impact in off-grid electricity, in the management of small farmers, timing of crop production, affordability of inputs, everything else. Again, technology becoming a real game changer. So for us, this is an exciting story of not where do you just find the extra capital, and we estimate that, you know, in infrastructure alone, there's a $2 trillion-plus spending gap, investment gap at the moment on an annualized basis, but it's also the application of this innovation of people who, you know, want to build profitable businesses, and it's trying to align that business incentive of profitability with a development issue of securing outcomes which are going to be transformational, we hope, for billions of people. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'm John MacArthur. We're just going to have our panel join here and get mic'd. So just give us a second while we all get seated. While they do, I'll just maybe go from that end to this end. I have one announcement to make, which is, you'll note, unfortunately, Professor Laura Alfaro, who was one of the commissioners at Harvard Business School and former minister in Costa Rica, due to the weather, tried to come from Boston today, but the flight was canceled. But very fortunately, Jane Nelson, so we have comedy across the river at Harvard from the Kennedy School, has stepped in to join us. Jane is the director of Corporate Responsibility Initiative at Harvard Kennedy School and one of the world's leaders on this issue, so we couldn't have a better person to join, so thank you, Jane. And I would add, just to introduce our colleagues, oh, and I'll get Mike too. Maybe I'll just slip over here and... Jane, just by way to introduce our panel, Jane is on many boards and advisory boards for many of the world's largest companies and has actually been very much living a lot of these questions for many years, so brings a lot of that deep perspective in addition to her own work and previous her own experience in the private sector as well. Next to her, we have Paul O'Brien, who's the Vice President for Policy and Campaigns at Oxfam, where he oversees research, policy, advocacy, and campaigning work. But he comes at this himself from many perspectives, having worked in places like Afghanistan, helping the Office of the President, Ministry of Finance, think through a lot of the policy reform and basic economic questions prior to that, CARE International prior to that, with Echo and Green, and also a litigator at Cravath, one of the world's major law firms. So really brings a range of perspectives. And Oxfam, as many of you know, has been really one of the world's leaders in thinking through everything from behind the brand, a campaign I hope you'll talk about a bit, but also this challenge of inequality that Elizabeth mentioned earlier. Next to him, we have Barry Parkin, who was mentioned, who has probably the best corporate job title I've seen in recent days, the Chief Sustainability and Health and Well-Being Officer of Mars. Which I think is appropriately all-encompassing of the range of issues we're talking about. I've recently come to describing the SDGs as about the battle for living standards around the world, because it really is that all-encompassing. And he's originally an engineer, but has been for three decades really in Mars across a variety of different types of responsibilities, and crucially also is chair of the World Cocoa Foundation, which is like the Global Industry Alliance for Cocoa, whereas in a previous life, I had the opportunity to work with some people in Mars in places like Cote d'Ivoire, where I know how seriously they take the long, long term for very obvious reasons about sourcing, so we'll be interested to hear from you. And I have to add, I also just learned today that Barry is a former Olympic sailor, so it really does come at this from a variety of perspectives of what excellence and well-being might mean. And Mark, of course, so delighted you have been able to share that, and thank you for your contributions. I should have said, I'm John MacArthur, I'm a senior fellow at Brookings, I'm also an advisor to the UN Foundation. And this, I want to thank Elizabeth and the UN Foundation for partnering with us on this event. We have a hashtag, BetterBiz, BETTERBIZ, for anyone who wants to share perspective with the room. We have a Facebook Live and a webcast that'll be circulated afterwards. So we want this conversation to go beyond the room very much. And with that, maybe we can start. We'll just hear from our panelists, and then I'll ask a few questions and open it up to the room. But Barry, maybe as a corporate representative and your CEO, just to convey Grant Reed, who is also very supportive of this whole effort, very engaged, it's very clear that even as a private company, without all the same types of public pressures, a huge private company, this has been a very fundamental exercise for you guys. How do you think about this report and what it means?
Thanks, John. I thought as a few opening comments to really talk about why Mars joined up with the Commission and what we're getting from this and what we hope to get from it going forward. So the I think fundamentally, when you think about better business, better world, that resonated very strongly with what we believe within Mars, and I think it resonated both at a principle level, but at a also at a very practical level. So if we think about from a principle level, we sort of trace our origins in this thinking in this space back 70 years, and the Mars business has been around about 100 years, but 70 years ago, 1947. So cast back to then, anybody who can. So we're just coming out of World War II, and the founder of the business, Forrest Mars Sr., wrote a letter to all of the employees of the business at that time. And in that letter, he wrote, "The purpose of the company is to create a mutuality of services and benefits with all stakeholders." And he went on to list those stakeholders, and he listed the shareholder, which was himself, the employees, customers, suppliers, government, and even competitors. So basically what he was saying was, we can only be successful as a company if all the people we touch are also being successful. And this was, I think, one of the earliest times people had thought about stakeholder value as opposed to just shareholder value. And thought about really the win-win. So it was clearly ahead of his time, and that's been, I think, at behind everything we've tried to do ever since in terms of creating this mutuality with everybody we touch. So from a principal point of view, great. But from a practical point of view, what this report is really making the case for that you can drive your P&L. You can drive the top line and the bottom line of your P&L. Whilst doing societal good. And there is an intersection, and there is not necessarily a trade-off. And I think, if you think about that at a very practical level, and I'll give you a couple of examples, we fundamentally believe this. So can you do this? Absolutely. And, we're a global food business. We operate around the world. We have factories all over the world. We source materials from all over the world. We sell products all over the world. But fundamentally a food business based on agriculture. So a couple of examples, and I'm going to test your SDG knowledge here. So SDG 13, who knows what that is? Excellent.
Climate change was the answer.
Climate action. So, how does that relate to Mars? So if you think about energy efficiency in our factories, that's just obvious, isn't it? You do that, you use less electricity, you save money, and it's good for the planet, good short-term return for the business. So some of these are obvious. But then if you think about the entire carbon footprint of our operation, and going back to agriculture and all of the activities involved with that, massive carbon footprint. We have a carbon footprint the size of some small countries. And, you know, what's the return on us working on that? And it may be not quite so obvious, but dig a little bit deeper. And, you know, if you believe, as we do, that there will be a price on carbon at some point, then there's a huge competitive advantage from reducing our carbon footprint and reducing it in line with what the science requires. So there's a long-term return on that. You know, a different example, if you think about SDG 1, no poverty. We have farmers in poverty at the start of our value chain, and that is unacceptable. And it's unacceptable from a moral point of view, but it's also unacceptable from a business point of view. It's in our interest that they're successful, because if they're not successful, they're going to do everything in their power to do something else with their lives than grow the crops that we want. So it is in our interest to make them successful, to get them to a sustainable living. And again, you have to think a bit harder about that, but there's a long-term return in that. And we can see that return, and that's why we invest in this. Some other areas are harder, you know, things like water, you know, investing in saving water around the world. It's hard to find a return on that because water is just so cheap. It's one of those... you know, it's one of those externalities which is very hard to bring into your P&L. But it's still the right thing to do, and you can find ways to get some return on that. So what we've learned through this process is if you really look at all of these things, some have great returns, some have medium returns, some it's harder to see a return. But if you take a portfolio approach, there is a return to this on the cost line. And then there's clearly, as Mark has talked about, a return on the top line. You know, we can design food products, as we do, to feed the developing world and to bring nutrition to the developing world. That's clearly good for the developing world, but it's also good for us. So, you know, there's some obvious top-line benefits. So we absolutely believe that there is a return, and we have measured that, and we're building business cases on that. So this is not about philanthropy. It's about win-win. And I guess, you know... What we want to do is we want to learn from others how to do this better, because we're all exploring how to do this, and we want to help start a movement. And I think that's really why we got involved with this.
Thank you, Barry. You know, it is interesting. And some of us were together yesterday, and I had the privilege and pleasure to work with Mark. I think you once referred to yourself as my other boss many years ago on getting the MDGs off the ground. And it was interesting reflecting, that was roughly 15 years ago, where really it was about bringing the governments of the world to wake up to a lot of these global issues. And we, you know, had some success on that, especially in global health, but less than others. But now it's kind of come back to the other side of the spectrum to get the companies to wake up, even while some of the governments are struggling, depending on which part of the world you're in. I'm curious, Jane, as someone who's been thinking about this issue of the business and the kind of forward-looking front-footedness of it, how does this report fit into the longer arc of, you know, how businesses think about the social license that Mark talked about?
Thank you. Thank you, John. And good afternoon, everyone. I mean, to me, there's no doubt, you know, both this report and I think the work of the Commission more broadly is a step change. Absolutely no doubt about that. And I think there are four key messages and themes that come out from the report for me and the work of the Commission that are particularly important in terms of taking us to that next stage of really mobilizing business competencies, capabilities, resources for development. I think the first is the report provides, to me, the most clear and compelling sort of data-driven, evidence-based analysis that I've seen to date in specific sectors, in these specific growth opportunity areas on what this means from both a business opportunity perspective but also a business risk perspective. And at the end of the day, any good business is about risk-adjusted returns and understanding your material risks and opportunities and managing both of them. And I think the report does a very good job. A lot of reports look just at the risk side and how we need to hold companies to account and ensure they don't do negative things and cause harm and abuse of human rights in the environment. There are other reports that are all about the opportunity side. And I think this report has done a superb job of quantifying very specific opportunities in the specific sectors, which are relevant for companies across a wide range of industry sectors, and which, as Barry said, can both, you know, grow top line and bottom line. And then also demonstrating that, you know, the companies that either don't see and sort of embrace these opportunities have a risk and an opportunity cost of not doing so. But that also, as Mark said at the end of his comments, the companies that aren't respecting human rights, managing their environmental impact, their water, et cetera, face not just reputation risks, but business continuity risks, market volatility risks, and security risks, political risks, which have always been there, but I think are greater now because of some of the global trends we're seeing of climate change, water scarcity, fragile states than have been in the past. So first, it makes this compelling case, which is evidence-based, both for the opportunities to be harnessed, but also the risks for the companies that don't address it, and it goes across a range of industry sectors. I think secondly, and the report and the work of the Commission has been very insightful and incisive on the role of the financial sector and the capital markets. And again, there's often, sort of bland statements where we need to mobilize pension fund money and we need to ensure that we have inclusive finance. I'd strongly recommend, for those of you who are interested in the financial sector, in addition to the flagship report, there's another excellent report looking at sustainable finance and looking at everything about from the policy environment that we need to integrate sustainability into financial decision making to how do we make it more long-term in nature. And also, as Mark commented in his speech, how do we really focus in on this concept of blended finance and use increasingly limited public sector dollars to catalyze, mobilize, and enable private sector finance, whether it's in sustainable infrastructure, whether it's in certain healthcare areas, whether it's, as Barry is saying, some of those opportunity areas which are not immediately apparent as a profit generator for business, but with a little bit of catalytic finance or first loss guarantees could become commercially viable and then business can run with it and scale it. So very strong on the blended finance and increasingly looking at opportunities. How do we mobilize the hundreds of millions of dollars or billions of dollars of pension fund money and insurance money into the SDGs in both developed and developing economies? I think thirdly, this idea of a sector-based coalition, so companies working together in their industry sector, either just company to company or in some cases bringing NGOs into the partnership as well, but looking at issues that are relevant to a particular industry sector and making industry-wide commitments for change. So what are a few examples? The World Cocoa Foundation that Barry leads is one example in a particular value chain of cocoa. And the Consumer Goods Forum, which is a broader coalition of companies in both the retail and food production sector, coming together, they've made very specific public commitments on things like deforestation and climate change and carbon emissions. And they've put them out there and said, we as an industry are going to meet these commitments. They might not get there, but they've made an industry-wide commitment. And then they're going to be pushing and encouraging and cajoling each other to get there. Or GSMA, which is the sort of business coalition for the mobile technology industry, they've produced a report saying this is where mobile technology as an industry can support the SDGs, and then have set a sort of a roadmap on how they can get there. The Chemical Industry Association has developed a technology roadmap on what they think some of the technology breakthroughs are. So I think there's real potential to have these coalitions. And then some, and I'm sure my good colleague Paul will want to comment on this, like the Extractive Industries Transparency Initiative, which are extractive companies, oil, gas, and mining companies, coming together with investors and NGOs on improving revenue transparency. So, or the Bangladesh Alliance and the Bangladesh Accord, where apparel companies are working together, and there are two different ones, a European one and a US one, to improve safety standards in factories in Bangladesh. So I think real potential there that the Commission identifies. And then finally, I think to me, one of the big breakthroughs of the Commission's message is your business has its core competencies, its capabilities that it can apply through its operations, its value chains, from both a risk and opportunity perspective. But not enough is said of the public policy advocacy role of the private sector. And trade associations have always lobbied. I mean, business lobbies. And so there's the whole question of responsible lobbying, which the Commission has addressed. And then there's the question of creative, progressive lobbying around the Paris Climate Agreement, sustainable development, not getting rid of our critical soft power here in the US in terms of US aid and OPEC, et cetera. And I think that the Commission has highlighted that the policy voice of business is also incredibly important, both being responsible about it and the way they advocate, but also looking at new opportunities. I mean, like the We Mean Business Coalition that came together in the lead up to Paris, you're one of those coalitions going forward that are going to protect things like the Paris Agreement and the SDGs. So I think making that case at the level of the individual company from a risk and opportunity perspective, real clear analysis of the financial sector opportunities, the sort of sector-based coalitions and the policy voice of business are four areas where the Commission has been very clear and concise and offer enormous potential to now achieve a step change in terms of implementation if companies take the advice that's in this and the NGOs advocate to them that they do so.
Well, on that note, Paul, is this all rainbows and unicorns? Is this is this too good to be true, this message? Or how do you guys are here to keep the world honest as a mission. How do you see the report, but the broader challenge in front of us?
So thanks, John, and thanks, George and Homi, for inviting me, knowing that it is not Oxfam's job or my predisposition to talk about rainbows and unicorns. I was reminded in reading the report of a time in which, 2015, we thought the hard conceptual work of development had largely been done. The creative leadership had basically solved much of the how. We had a set of goals that were finally comprehensive and understood, that it wasn't just about naming the desired outcomes, but thinking through the machinery that would deliver those outcomes in a sustainable way. We'd named the right targets. It wasn't about the donors finding more aid. It was about corporations and governments being incentivized correctly to achieve those targets. And we put that magic sauce into the equation, which was to recognize finally that governments and corporations are never going to be incentivized to achieve the sustainable development goals or anything else beyond their core purpose if there aren't correction mechanisms for that to happen. And the most effective corrective mechanism we've come at, flaws and all, is the engagement of citizens and civic life. That was the powerful epiphany of the Sustainable Development Goals. And most of us thought we were going to be having a conversation about implementation. How are we going to speed this up? How are we going to get it done? Who's going to be the corporation that gets there first in terms of the race at the top? Which government's going to be most accountable? And then we have these elections. And I'm sitting in a room last week. We're going to convene a development conversation, and I promise you this is true. We were literally trying to decide if we could put the word global into it without losing half the audience. We have an accelerated level of deregulation of the corporate sector going on now in the areas of tax and transparency. That great 10 years of work. We put 10 years of work into getting a piece of legislation passed that would require oil, mining, gas companies to declare the terms of their deals with developing country governments. This was part of the inevitable trajectory that we were all a part of. In one fell swoop 3 weeks ago, it's gone. All that work's gone. The possibility of knowing what's going to be in those deals, gone, because this Congress decided to remove it. The obsession of this America First ideology with getting rid of the free rider problem is creating such a morally impoverished notion of what it means to engage globally, this zero-sum transactional perspective on foreign policy, that our chances of sitting in rooms and talking about larger realities like the Sustainable Development Goals is completely different today than it was 5 months ago. So when I read this report, I'm afraid I read it in today's world. And I want to say, I'm about to make a couple of critiques, but also a couple of compliments. But I say these believing sincerely that what Mark Malloch-Brown and the Commission did was so important, in part because of who they were. This was the most visionary, courageous group of corporate leaders who understood the practicalities of it. So I say what I'm about to say with a sense of the opportunity there. and the high expectations that I had for the process. So I want to make two reflections on where I think our concerns come out. The first was, you know, asking the question about, well, what's the real purpose of the commission and this report in these times? And the way it's articulated right now, it's to make the business case for the relevance of the SDGs and why they're good for corporations and they can do good while doing this. And so I find myself asking, in these times, is that the most important question for this great group of thinkers and leaders to be asking? And at one level, it kind of is, because the relevance of the SDGs is no longer assured in any way. There is no inevitability to the trajectory. The fact that it's a United Nations endorsed process is probably a bad thing in these times now. So making the case to corporations to step up and fill the leadership void and to understand why it's good for them is probably a politically very astute thing to still to be trying to do. And so I applaud those efforts. But I also find myself in these times saying, you know, making the opportunity case to corporations right now for the SDGs may not be the biggest challenge of our time, because what we want from corporations in the end of the day is not an embrace of the SDGs. We want them to embrace the goals, the development outcomes, the impact on people living in poverty at the end of it. If they were to do that through better business, whether they did it through the SDGs or not is far less important. It's the relevance case. On the one hand, the opportunity that the way that the report is framed and the way that the argument is made is all about opportunities. And we find ourselves asking, well, if you moved out of that opportunity mindset and you just ask yourself, what's the obligation to think about impact? Would you have had a different report? And would, over the precious last months of this commission's life, would you be trying to get different conversations started? I'll give you an example. The report talks a lot about fossil fuels, energy, the automotive industry. But because it's framed in terms of opportunity, it's looking for arguments that can get corporations to think creatively about what's in it for them. But of course, if you're thinking in terms of broader impact about automotives and fossil fuels and energy, you think about, well, what's the broader impact and what are the things we want to be concerned about? The automotive example in the paper is called... It's called circular models. Here's the big idea for the automotive industry. There may be smart ways to recycle old cars to get them to be parts of new cars so that we're not constantly using up more and more stuff. That's a great idea. It's not bad. But if you put that up against the emissions challenge that the automotive industry is creating for our world now, and you had a commission report that talked about how automotive companies have to lead the fight on lowering emissions, and you did it from a responsibility perspective rather than from an opportunity perspective, you would have had a different section there. So when you talk opportunity, you sometimes do it at the cost, in terms of airtime, of answering the question, what's the broader impact that the corporate sector would be having? And I hope that the commission spends a bit more time on that. Here's the second question and challenge that I had with the paper. If you buy what I said at the very beginning, that we were right way back when, and we continue to be right, and Mr. Malloch-Brown was right in saying that without a strong social compact, none of this will work in the end, because it isn't just about better ideas. It's about incentive mechanisms and accountability structures and institutions that are required, not choosing to. That's the difference between the MDGs and the SDGs, right? The MDGs, think about the power dynamics in the MDG model. It was a beneficiary-focused argument. Yes, it sought to get commitments from governments, but in the end of the day, the real achievement of the MDGs was to get those who had a lot of power to choose to do more for those who didn't have enough. The epiphany of the SDGs was that we needed a different power dynamic in development. It needed to be about tax and spend and regulation and investments. Not what you choose to do, but what you must do. The key question when it comes to social compacts is twofold. One, do we have the best ideas in how to form social compacts? And two, do we have the politics right? Do we understand the power dynamics? I am incredibly grateful to have seen these leaders take the time and make the space to devote a whole chapter of great ideas towards the social compact. I think that is a huge step change in the conversation to have. Read chapter 5 very carefully if you can. It's chock full of great ideas. My challenge is that it is not just about great ideas. Look at the headings. It's about better ideas for employment, better ideas for work, better ideas for training, better ideas for skills. Those are great. But the social compact is about politics and it's about power. And there has to be some discussion of the incentives to actually unpack the politics and power in the equation. And the airtime that this commission takes in its last months to actually unpack that and get it right is going to be critical, in my sense, to how the corporate sector steps into, in more robust ways, this conversation. I provoked a little bit. So one example of where, in your comment, Jane, yes, it's absolutely critical that we get the some creative ideas around how the finance sector engages, and we think about unlocking that money. But when you have 100 companies controlling $74 trillion in assets, $74 trillion, that is gross world product, 100 companies. It isn't just about making sure that they have the best ideas to invest in sustainable development. It's about making sure that they cannot destroy the currency of nations and the well-being of millions of people by the power they exercise there. It's about controlling that power. So my last comment to try and bring home this, as I was reading the report, and again, much of it nodding my head to it because the ideas were genius, I remember, some of you may have seen this, David Souter did a talk in 2012. I don't know if any of you saw it. If you haven't, Google David Souter and civic life. And I think if he didn't say the word social contract, it was all about social contracts. And he basically said, you know, the problem, he was asked by the moderator, what?
I'm going to have to ask you to keep it brief.
Last thing. What keeps you awake at night? And Souter said, you know what keeps me awake at night? It's not foreigners coming here and harming us or hurting us or setting off bombs. That's not what disturbs me. What disturbs me is that people don't really understand anymore how powerful institutions work, what incentivizes those institutions, how they're held accountable, and how to engage them. And when people don't understand how powerful institutions work, what happens is somebody comes along and says, you don't need to know how powerful institutions work. I'll do it for you. And you can engage directly with me, and I'll solve your problems. You can go back to your lives and do other things. I'll take care of governance for you. And when that happens, he said, democracy dies. We are in a political moment like nothing we've seen. And the powerful actors here are governments and their corporations. And how corporations choose to engage that fundamentally political conversation about the social contract is going to determine whether we move towards a healthier world in the coming years. And so my hope is that this great group of visionary leaders takes that challenge on while they take on all of the great ideas that are in this report as well to make sure that the development that we might have is sustainable. Thanks, John, for giving me
the
time.
Thank you, Paul. Yeah. I think all the comments, and I'm going to ask Mark to share some thoughts, and then we'll open it up. But I think these comments, and if I can use my prerogative as moderator to interject a little bit, they kind of throw down the gauntlet at one stage. But they also reveal what I would call a very deep complexity of what's going on in the world right now. So many people, it depends, even our colleague Carol Graham measures happiness around the world. You know, she talks about how we're going through a sadness. She's become a sadness expert in the US because there's a whole suicide belt. We have declining life expectancies and certain demographics. But in other parts, Latin America, people are extremely happy. They think their life's great, better than it's ever been. Certain parts of Asia, you get very different answers. So the global perspective on what's going on is different. Even on global issues, very few people know we're in the middle of arguably the greatest generation of all time, without question, in global cooperation on health issues. It's extraordinary. You know, I did a recent estimate, at least 20 million lives saved. You know, this is big, big stuff. Even while other parts of the international cooperation are falling apart at the seams. All these things are true at the same time. And I think this is, laying down the gauntlet, but for you of all people, Mark, I can't think of a person who understands power better than you in all of its different phases around the world, having been on both ends of the sticks in many different constituencies, literally everything from business to media to multilateral to bilateral, where you were at defending the UN from the US attacks. You were, you know, on the other side of it in other places. And I think there's a core question what everyone's raised, which is, you know, what's the theory of change to go from here? What's the strategy to move forward?
Well, look, I mean, John, your 20 million lives saved in public health, you know, a lot of it you attribute generously to the MDGs, you know, which were, you know, a pretty limp set of goals, deeply criticized when we first drew them up. And entirely voluntary, really. I mean, when the MDGs were adopted, Colin Powell was just coming in as Secretary of State, and I remember pleading with him to even use the term MDGs. And because he was a good guy, he did. And then his president followed. But, you know, it was not, you know, this...
5 years later. it took a while.
But... You know, this thing worked because people saw a common interest in coming together around it, limp, flaccid, committee document though it was. And, you know, the SDGs similarly have no real enforcement power around them. They are, again, you know, voluntary. But I would say that, you know, this report, and, you know, I'm very glad you're not a litigator anymore. I think there must be a lot of criminals who are very relieved that their sentences will all be shorter because it's now applied to this instead. But, you know, the point really was, you know, development people talk to development people all the time and they say what the obligations and what the policies should be. You know, I, as a development person, actually wanted to sort of harness business people to help me talk in a language of business to business. So I'm absolutely unapologetic about it being about opportunity. And frankly, in Trump's America, that has become even more important because, you know, we can't rely on, you know, a conveniently supportive policy and business environment, policy environment to shape business. We've got to count on business seizing the opportunity and being a leader. And so I don't apologize for that. Just on the mobility point, because you know, the one good thing is about a litigator is suitably selective reading of evidence. and I must just say that we cite, you know, mobility is a $2 trillion issue. And I promise you, it's not from recycling old Oldsmobiles. You know, we anticipate new mass transit systems. We anticipate, you know, 95% of a car's life, as we put out in the report, it's usually idle, taking up urban or other space. So it's very much, you know, and rather controversially, we seem to endorse the whole issue of the disruptive industries of Uber, etc., and of self-driving cars, which, you know, have employment consequences which need to be reflected on. But, you know, the point is, in each sector, we are thinking big. It's not just your little bit of environmental sort of stuff at the margin. You know, these are meant to be big, fat, transformational ideas which business can get really excited about. And that, for me, goes to the PowerPoint, because, you know, if business moves, then hopefully the world follows in this case.
That's a great point. I want to open it up to see, you know, any questions, we'll keep it to minimum on the comments, please. So if you could just introduce yourself and, you know, keep it brief and make sure it ends with a question mark. That would be terrific. So maybe we'll take a couple and then come up to the panel. So, yeah, this gentleman here.
Thank you. Hi. Thanks to you all and thanks to Brookings. This is a fascinating event, a wonderful discussion. My name is Douglas Kerr. I'm with the National Cooperative Business Association here in Washington, D.C. We are a trade association for co-ops and for people who believe in using the co-op model to build a better world. We have also been, for 65 years, essentially an NGO doing development activities. My question is really for Barry Parkin. I was fascinated by what you were saying about how you can actually make the business case that investing in clean energy, investing in reducing poverty, set aside water, your third example, will have a long-term payoff. When I get out of here, I'm going to go all over your website. But my question is there research, studies, data that could be used to take that argument to other businesses in other value chains and say, look, these guys have proved it. If you invest in clean energy in your factories, then it will have a positive effect on your bottom line. So we can, you know, as NGOs, as businesses, successfully make the case that other businesses should look beyond the quarterly P&L. Thanks very much.
Jane might have thoughts on that too. Maybe we'll take a couple over this, the woman in the golden jacket, if we could pass the mic.
Hi. A fellow student.
Sorry, could you just introduce yourself, please?
My name is Barbara Dello, and a fellow student from my college once told me, he was from a faraway country in Africa, and he said, we don't want you to come in transforming our and imposing your way on our country. It just feels like colonization again. In this past election, America rejected the best ideas of both political parties. In view of that, should there be more outreach to regular folks and be more respectful of what they want for their lives, their communities, and nations, rather than, just have Washington and UN people and policymakers always assume that their ideas are best for what's the lives of regular people?
Thank you. And I'm going to take the liberty of paraphrasing that a little bit. I think there's a question of big business versus little business and smaller entrepreneurs that are closer maybe to communities. Yeah, this gentleman.
Javed Hamid. I'm retired from International Finance Corporation. And Mark Malloch-Brown, we worked together at one time, so I have great respect for what you're doing. I have two short, maybe a question and a comment. The comment really is that in my dealing with businesses from in my earlier career and in financing, and then currently dealing with education institutions, and this is in developing countries and in several of them. And what I see is that when you go, there may be an understanding of these issues at a high level of senior or executives, but as you go down in the organization, people say, you know, this is all to raise our costs and it doesn't help anybody, and therefore, how can we subvert this whole thing? Unless there is some market pull driving it, that their products will not be able to sell in a market, no way, it's not a conviction. So what do we do? That's number one. Second is in education institutions. You can walk into a lot of developing countries, university level, into a classroom. And you see I have not seen any serious discussion of what these issues mean for the way people do their business. And this may be in the science area, it may be in the arts, business schools. And basically, if you raise this issue, and I'll give you one single example, and that's
I'm just going to have to ask you very brief, please.
One final thing, that in Pakistan, for example, there's a lot of movement towards using coal for power generation, and it's being financed by China, et cetera. And you talk to people in the universities and things, and they say, well, this is not an issue. We have lots of coal, and therefore, that's it. So again, I want to what I'm posing to you is how do we get down to this level where a broad mass of people begin to believe in this and want to deliver on these issues? Thank you very much.
Maybe did I see another hand? Right. Maybe get one more and then a badge. I think this point. I'll just paraphrase as you pass the mic. This gentleman here. This question of how to get down, this is something I know Laura Alfaro wanted to speak about. As a business school professor, active, how do we get to the next generation is one bit of this, but also, if I heard your first bit, it's getting into the companies, getting deep in there, so beyond the CEO level, which maybe, again, Barry would have some thoughts on, the value chain and the supply chain, how it all fits. If you could be brief, please. Yes.
Yes. So my name is Carlos Rodriguez. I'm a business student from the University of Texas at Dallas. And my question is, when you're quantifying the value of things like conflict prevention, which might not be readily seen, what are some of the ways that you can quantify that to have to show to businesses the return on investment for initiatives in conflict prevention?
Well, maybe just jump in on anyone's. Don't have to answer all of them individually, but maybe Barry, any questions or thoughts to start?
Is there evidence of this business return? Is it proven? I think the answer to that is partly. And every week I can read three or four studies which look at this from one angle or another and give a view that there is an ROI on investing against the SDG. So I would say there's a growing body of evidence from academia, from business consultancies, from the corporate world, and interestingly, from the financial world. There are hundreds of investors, hedge funds that are investing behind the premise of sustainable businesses deliver better returns, and they all have their angle on that. So what I'd say is there's a growing weight of evidence, and from our point of view, I've had to prove the case. We have the principle, but I've also had to prove the case. Our founders and shareholders are also hard-nosed business people, and so I think you can prove the case. And of course, there is some small leap of faith that goes with that, but I think there's enough evidence to convince.
And Barry, just this notion of the depth of the human resource chain, the supply chain. If someone's in Pakistan or East Asia or anywhere else in between, what's the incentive or mindset for getting a company or a corporate structure to take stuff like this on?
Within the structure?
Yeah.
It's interesting. I think typically the motivations are strongest at the top and at the bottom. And, typically it's the millennials who are starting out in the organization or who are leading the charge here. The challenge is actually more in the middle, middle management who, didn't grow up with these values and haven't seen the big picture yet. So I think that's more the organizational challenge. So the people at the bottom of our organization are fired up about this.
Mm. Yeah.
Great. I think I'm picking up on both those comments. I think there's sort of two questions implicit in your comments. One was how we're integrating environmental and social costs and sort of benefits into business decision making, and then also that sort of short term, that quarterly short term pressure. And I think there is more and more evidence on the benefits of integrating the risks and the opportunities within companies, but then they're still facing those short-term investor pressures. And so some of the most interesting developments, I think, in the last year have been several groups of asset managers, and I can give you some contacts afterwards, have come together around this whole concept of long-term capitalism and long-term stewardship. And some of the biggest asset managers, including some of those that Paul mentioned, are actually starting to say we need to rethink our corporate governance models so they are more long-term in nature. I think another interesting trend, and your movement is part of it, rethinking business models and cooperative models, B Corps, as well as some of the other better known business models. What business models are best fitted for the future? I think in terms of getting things down the corporate hierarchy, at the end of the day, it needs that leadership from the top, because I don't think it does get sustained, however energetic the employees are, unless there's the leadership from the top. But the culture change comes partly from that leadership, partly from the employees caring. But there's also something about incentives. So just like the external market incentives, unless these issues get integrated, I think, into performance appraisals and bonuses and benefits, it's hard for them to become truly embedded. And more companies, including a number of the companies on the commission, are very explicitly putting these into the incentives of their employees. So I'll leave it at that. And then I certainly on the sorry very quickly, as a professor, I can't ignore the question from the student. I think a really important question. In fact, by complete coincidence, I've just come from a meeting with Chevron and the Niger Delta Partnership Initiative, where and I'd recommend you look at their some of the research they've done to try and both quantify but also make a sort of qualitative case for their peace building and conflict prevention as part of business continuity in an enabling environment. And and then linked to that, revenue transparency has to be part of it as well. So again, there's an interesting movement, and if you sort of Google business and peace, of companies beginning to look at the peace SDG, and you can't clearly quantify all of it, but saying that it's crucial to creating a stable enabling environment in which we can do business, and therefore business can't sort of say we've got nothing to do with conflict prevention and peace building. So, and again, going back to Paul's comments, at a minimum, be responsible for not being intentionally or unintentionally the cause of conflict, and then also proactively looking at peace building, community capacity building, early warning, data systems, et cetera, that can try and address some of these challenges.
Paul, and I think this point on real people,
yeah.
I'd be curious your thoughts.
I'm going to try and say some nice things now.
You said lots of nice things.
Well, one of the things I really did like about the report was that it took seriously the externalities question and the pricing of it. I loved the question from Carlos, though, because I think we're going to have reached that true step change when we think about externalities in a more reflective way that people care about. You asked any survey I've ever done, security and peace and how well they're governed, they are the things they care even more about than climate and whatever. I would love to see, if we're not going to stop it, the pricing of the impacts on conflict, the impacts on governance. Price it and make them pay for it. If they're going to make dirty deals, it should come at a cost. But just about for companies that don't make dirty deals, I want to say one of the nice things, because Oxfam, as a campaigning organization, realized that the irony of our private sector work at some level was that the best companies to campaign with were the ones that were most responsible and engaged in understanding that their relationship with ordinary people, with consumers, was key to their long-term models. So perhaps our most successful campaign was with very brand-sensitive companies like Mars and Unilever and others that were deeply committed to the ideas we've been talking about. And so the irony was, the first, and I think this is the most recent time I've met you, I'm in this strange situation of asking you to do stuff, and you're like, oh, we've done that. And well, okay, well, you need to do this. Well, we've actually done that. I'm right. Well, just keep doing it. was that conversation. But it is very good to see that leadership coming from those companies, and it's just unfortunate that you're often the ones that get targeted as a consequence.
We've been encouraging you to look at some other people. Some other parts of the value chain.
Mark.
Well, look, very quickly, because it'd be great to get some more questions. I mean, this issue of shoving it down the people of Africa or anyone else's throats, I think, the thing about business is it only works when it sells people things they want. And what's so striking in the examples the report takes in Africa are the way the development of apps and other innovations to solve very local African problems of solar distribution or access to banking where there aren't banks, et cetera, et cetera. So it's not a bunch of sort of Western multinational products getting shoved down African consumers or anyone else's things in a way that they don't want. And, I think companies only succeed when they adjust to their local markets. But I think the other point to say, and I'm very glad Laura Faro is not here, because she doesn't completely agree with me on this number, but 90% of private sector job creation is small and medium-sized enterprises. And, that is particularly the case in developing countries. So, these are local businesses rooted in the communities they serve. So it's not really the model you... I hope it's not the model you fear. And just one extra point on the conflict prevention, which is, the Delta is a very good example, but the global macro example is if 10% of global GDP is being spent on security, that's coming out of companies, their employees, and their stakeholders' pockets, and that's 10% that could be spent on other things. Mm. And so, you know, I'm sure it's great for defense contractors, but for the rest of industry and their employees, that is a huge tax that this current risk-prone sort of market shock economy that we have puts people under. And I look, the final point, just say to my old friend, you know, look, we've got a hell of a job to do in the classroom, starting with the professors. And actually, his other boss, he nicely called me one, Jeff Sachs, has just done a brilliant set of MOOCs for business students, along with a former finance minister of Chile. And they really hit at a lot of this. And we're also trying to get into the MOOC business and, you know, to sort of reach out at the education classroom level on this. Mm.
We have time for maybe one more question. I would add, we have a lot of other expertise in the room. We have Homi Karas, who's many people know, one of the fathers of the SDGs. We have Amar Bhattacharya, who's a leader on the whole sustainable infrastructure effort. We have George Ingram, who's helping to a lot of the U.S. Corporate community think about how it takes this stuff on. So we won't be able to hear from everyone today, but you know, please know for afterwards and follow up. Maybe we can just take one or two very, very quick. I'm going to ask you to be as brief as possible, please. Sir. And then the woman in the very back next.
Tachu, IAC. I think reading the report is a wonderful report. I think it shows that we're living in a time, and I hope the esteemed panelists can shed some light on this. You know, my thinking about, you know, we're living in a time of ideological convergence as well as confusion. The convergence is that we are all recognizing that we cannot leave the markets alone. We need a government intervention. The confusion is, what is the right government intervention, right? I mean, the two superpowers are meeting today. On one side, I think we the report is recommending that we need to jack up the intervention. We need to beef up branded finance and so on. But on the other side, I think we recognize, or maybe we see, that there's too much intervention, you know, in all those new emerging industries. The government's too much. But so what is the right level?
Great question. Balance of intervention, and the woman in the back row, please.
Hi, thank you. My question is for Mr. Parkin. It's just a question of whether you feel the food and beverage industry faces a unique challenge, because across all industries, there are challenges like making sure that you're supporting producers or making sure that you're more environmentally friendly. But the food and beverage industry has the unique challenge of the products themselves potentially or proving if they're unhealthy, contributing to the global burden of disease. There have been reports saying that of all of the, you know, the large majority of the contributions to global disease and death are diet related. So beyond being more environmentally friendly or more transparent, what challenges or what incentives can there be for the food and beverage industry to look at the products themselves? For example, with the oil industry, the product stays the same. Even if you're more transparent, the product is the same. But with the food and beverage industry, there's kind of those both challenges of being more transparent, but then also looking at your chips and your soda. How do you create incentives to change those things as well? Thank you.
So we have two incredibly complex questions to close this off. And I'm going to be unfair as moderator to maybe just go down the line to ask any thoughts you might have on those. And if I might add, I think my view on one of the great contributions of this report is, even though the title is business, the analysis is industry, because that's how companies actually see themselves as competing within their industry. Coke doesn't compete against Exxon, it competes against Pepsi and so forth, and Tata and so forth. So that's the crucial bit. But Jane, any quick thoughts?
Right, I think very quickly on the food and beverage question, I think there definitely are additional responsibilities, and I'll leave it mostly to Barry on that front. But I think you know, his company and others are very much looking at their product range as well. You know, and that wasn't necessarily the case with many of them even 5 years ago. So, and you know, it has partly come from activism and you know, consumer activists and others. But so I think there's movement happening on that. Ted, you're wonderful, but a very challenging question. I think there's some, you know, really obvious interventions, like, you know, internalizing the cost of carbon, and then you're putting a price on carbon, which are pretty global and pretty universal. And then I think, you know, there's a number which are going to be more industry-based, and it sort of comes full circle back to some of Paul's comments, and that, you know, is industry collectively going to, you know, lobby in a very, you know, retroactive way, or be more progressive, seeing some of these big global trends that are happening demographically, environmentally, socially, and, you know, recognizing that they've got to, you know, work with government, in some cases with civil society, around, you know, regulations which they might not have actually advocated for in the past, or are they going to, through their trade associations, you know, be blocking or pushing back regulations. And frankly, there's, you know, there's I think a bit of schizophrenia at the level of a lot of individual companies right now, that, you know, they're sort of supporting trade associations, they're doing one thing, and then they're being very progressive on the same thing through other coalitions. So, you know, that's an area of sort of responsible lobbying that is going to, you know, continue to be crucially important.
So very briefly, not surprisingly, I would love to see more regulations on the issues of externalities and better pricing of them, and more regulations on opening up corporations to their customers and to citizens over time, so that we have a race to the top and better corrective mechanisms for corporations. And I'm just really looking forward to hearing Barry's answer.
Yeah, I'm going to leave the first one then. So, you know, are there big challenges to food and bev? Absolutely. And, you know, the sustainability ones are obvious. You know, the fact that food and bev is based on agriculture, and agriculture is a huge contributor to the environmental challenges, and also a hugely connected to the social challenges. You know, the poorest people in the world live in, you know, work in agriculture. So there's monstrous challenges from a sustainability point of view. But you didn't ask about that. You asked about the health and well-being side. I think the opportunity here is to think about the health and well-being from both sides of this. You know, there's an equal number of people that are obese and challenged by those diseases as there are that are under nutrition. And, you know, what has packaged foods done over the 100 years? It has innovated, found ways to you know, produce convenient, affordable, food-safe, attractive ingredients. Now, that's gone too far in the case of obesity. So how do we dial that back and be part of the solution rather than the problem? But equally on the other side, we can be a huge part of the solution in terms of affordable nutrition on the other side. So, you know, we have a responsibility on both sides, I think. And what you see is us, you know, working on both sides of the problem. And clearly we have a lot of work to do. And you heard my job title. I think there's plenty to do.
Well, let me just take that, the first question. And, you know, I think I see Gavin Wilson at the back, who, head of IFC Asset Management, a commissioner, colleague of yours, and very much one who's, you know, been one of our leaders on this whole blended finance issue, which is so much at the core of this. You know, what I've tried to do as chairman is make sure, because I would just say I agree completely with your point about two superpowers, but I think on this issue of blended finance, there are two opposing ideas of the concept, both valid. Here in the West, it's all about trying to get the BAAL regulators and others to kind of just stop being so itchy about making capital so liquid. How can capital, that big sort of savings mountain of pensioners who want a great return but want it 20 years from now, how can you match that 20-year patience for investment with a regulatory system that wants you to have instant liquidity in case 2009 happens again? So you've got these particular sort of market sensitivities around Western capital. Around Asian capital, and particularly Chinese state capital, if I can put it that way, the issue is completely different, and the numbers tell a very different story of very large amounts of state development capital going into infrastructure, not just in China, but the whole One Belt, One Road, Africa as well now, et cetera, et cetera. But not necessarily being as effective as it might be in leveraging private capital to match it. So, you know, it seems to me as we sort of move down this road of trying to find the solutions to blended capital, we've got to understand these different systems and find solutions to both get them to work better together, but also to generate these much higher ratios of, say, you know, I mean, if you read World Bank and IFC literature, you see bragging stuff about $20 of private capital for every dollar of public. Well, I'm not sure. But those are the kind of numbers that we need to try and get to. And if I may, and I know we've got to stop, just one final observation, other than thanks to all the people you mentioned, Amar and Homi and George and the UNF team as well. And that's this, you know, what I think has been most striking about the companies involved in this, the Unilevers, the Marses, the others, is their stories of the millennials who want to go work for them. It's an extraordinary story. Barry was yesterday telling me that apparently 2 million people tried to get jobs at Unilever or something. There's a sort of LinkedIn thing which measures job interest, and Unilever is now right up there with Google and Facebook as the three top, you know. And it is extraordinary. What is it about? It's about companies which are introducing purpose and social contribution, judging them, putting themselves forward as judges by the social capital we build, the social results we achieve, as well as by our P&L, to take Barry's point. It's not as an alternative to the P&L, but it's integrated into their vision of how you make a great company that lasts, retains and recruits talent, secures a long-term position in the Fortune 500 or whatever local stock market it's on, is about attending to all of this. We have moved from the one-dimensional P&L company of the past. And, you know, that's, for me, been the most exciting discovery of working with these companies over the last year or so.
Amazing. Well, I do want to thank all of our panelists, and all of them, especially Jane, for last minute joining, but very much all of them. And I want to thank all of the audience for braving the elements to come here today. Your revealed preference is clearly a commitment to the issues. But I'd also like to join in thanking UN Foundation and Pratik Desai and others who are so instrumental in our whole team, Madeline, Josh, Merrill, everyone who's been so instrumental, Jennifer Tyre, and everyone to help this get together today. But I'd also like to, in addition to our distinguished panelists, just give an extra special thanks to Mark, because for those of you who don't know, I can say very sincerely there, I don't know of many other people, if, you know, there are no better, let me put it that way, who have committed themselves to getting diverse people to find new ways to work together to solve the biggest problems the world faces. And he's got a lot on his, he doesn't need to do a project like this. And you do it because you care so much, and the world's better for it. So thank you, Mark, for coming today. And thanks, everyone.